It's great to see you all here today. I'm glad you're here present. We have a special Sunday ahead of us. My name is Rebecca Goldtree Moore, and I'm one of the pastors here. And it's an honor to be able to welcome you this Sunday. If you have a worship bulletin, I'm going to invite you to fill out this side perforated tab. It has a little bit of information or ways we can be praying for you. And then when it comes time for the offering, you can tear it and put it in the offering plate. If you're worshiping with us online or from home, we invite you to register your attendance using our church website, firstwichita.org. Today is Pastor Cindy's final Sunday preaching in the pulpit, and so I realize we have some guests here, and we're so happy that you're here, and we just wanted to extend hospitality from First Church. If you are interested in learning more about the ministries here, there will be people from hospitality with little welcome bags in the narthex following the service. Also, following the service, there is going to be a luncheon and celebration for Cindy. There will be plenty of food. You're invited to come right after worship. So friends, let us now center ourselves in mind, body, and spirit as we prepare to worship our living God. Thank you.
Welcome to First United Methodist Church in downtown Wichita. This is Downtown Alive, where we strive to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world.
Welcome to worship as we continue our sermon series, Hinge Moments Reflection. I'd like to welcome all of you who are joining us in person. I know there are people here from all over the state, many of you that I've served in a variety of congregations. Thank you for being here, as well as family and other friends and members at First Church. I'd also like to welcome those who are joining us through Cake TV, Facebook Live, and YouTube. Welcome to First United Methodist Church in downtown Wichita, Kansas. I am so grateful that you are worshiping with us today on my last Sunday as I transition into the retired status. I'd invite you to register your attendance through our church app or through our website. We would love to know that you are worshiping with us, and there are many volunteer opportunities, or we'd invite you to share with us how we can pray for you. We are in a hinge moment. We are transitioning, me personally and you as well. And what a great way to transition together as we focus on the word that comes to us, as we focus on the fact that in this very room, there is enough love and grace and joy and hope for us all. So as we continue in worship, our opening hymn is the one that we sang my very first Sunday here in 2016. It's one of my very favorites. It is Praise to the Lord the Almighty. It's number 139 in your United Methodist hymnal. Would you please stand as you are able?
Thank you.
seated. Let us now join together in prayer in posture, mind, and spirit. Let us pray. Holy and loving God, maker of heaven and earth, we gather together in your name. Gracious God, in love you created us, and in love you sustain us day after day. So it is with confidence that we bring our prayers to you, knowing that you hear us and you will respond. Today we offer prayer for the daily tasks that consume us. O God, we accomplish nothing without your grace, and so we offer prayers for the work that we do. O God, we offer prayers for the world around us, for those places in our globe that hurt, that are broken, where there is poverty, where there's hunger, where there is disaster around. Oh God, we offer prayers for the church universal. We offer prayers that you are the head of the church and that we are your disciples looking for your calling in our lives. We offer prayers for the sick, the isolated, and the grieving. Oh God, we ask that you would shepherd them with compassion and your ever-abundant love. On this day, when we come to recognize and honor your good and faithful servant, Reverend Cindy Watson, we acknowledge the many ripples of love, wisdom, care, and laughter she shared with all of the community she served and that she will continue to share as she becomes retired. We come to this day with joy for her faithful calling that she has lived into for 41 years. We come to this day ready to celebrate. And finally, God, we pray for ourselves, for members of your body here on earth. We ask that you would break down the barriers that divide us from one another, that you would unite us in our common allegiance to you as Lord and Savior. Grant us compassion, humility, and love in all our relationships. Release the gifts that you have given each one of us so that in us and through your light, we can shine brighter. Come among us, living Lord. Through your power of the Holy Spirit, transform our hearts and minds so that we may recognize your presence, hear your voice, know your will, and walk in your way. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray in this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our first reading today comes from Paul's letter to the church at Rome, and it's a significant portion of the 12th chapter, which begins by encouraging the community of faith. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. That very verse was in my third grade Bible. I think that verse goes in a lot of third grade Bibles. It also goes in a lot of senior and high schools, Bibles, and gifts. It's a reminder that Christ changes us. And when we're open to the transformation of what Christ brings, we can work toward what is good and right and just. And it sets up for the call and the challenge to live out that grace as the body of Christ through the gifts that we're given. Paul has some pretty definite opinions about what that looks like and how we should live out our faith through how we interact with each other and with the world. Listen now to Paul's call and challenge from the 12th chapter of Romans.
I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all.
I know that's a long passage, but I can't ever figure out what to cut out, because it says so many deep things that I think are true for followers of Christ Jesus. And we're following it up with a gospel reading from the gospel according to St. Luke, the 6th chapter. Now, Luke's focus is always on those who are left out. From the beginning, Luke creates this vision of God's kingdom linked to the prophets, who again and again challenge people to live into a reign, a kingdom that reflects God. God as Lord, God's justice, God's love, God's grace. And the 6th chapter begins with arguments about the law and what's acceptable, which brings us right up to the Sermon on the Plain, which is Luke's version of Matthew's Sermon on the Mount. Jesus blesses and instructs and challenges. And like Matthew's sermon, it begins with the Beatitudes. The difference is Luke doesn't spiritualize them. Luke is clear that it's blessed are the poor and the meek. Blessed is the outcast. And Luke also tends to point out that it's not going to be good for those that overlook these challenges. But then we get to the reading this morning, which I think is a great pairing with the words from Paul that we just heard. Would you please stand as you are able as we hear this portion of Jesus' Sermon on the Plain from the 6th chapter of Luke.
But I say to you that listen, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you, and if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them do to you. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, do good and lend. Expect nothing in return. Your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, for He is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven.
The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. On Sunday, June 6, 1982, I began my ministry in Alden, Kansas. I still have that first sermon, by the way. It looks like this. That's my first sermon I ever wrote. And these are the words I began with. What a way to begin. I stand on the shoulders of great men and women, and it is encouraging me that Reverend O'Kelly and Reverend Latimer are up here with me, and it is with pride that I follow in their footsteps here. I would like to publicly thank both of you, I said, for your ministries. And what a way to begin for all of us to be here, to begin my ministry, knowing that you will pray for me, that you will be teaching me and bearing with my mistakes and faults. We are truly one body, each of us with our own talents, and yet through Christ, we are one body, one faith, and in this faith, we celebrate the Lord's Supper, which in itself is a beginning and an ending. Jesus' life on earth has ended, but for the disciples, it was just beginning. What a way to begin by breaking bread, as thousands have done before us, celebrating our faith. I'd say 41 years later, it's not a bad way to end either. Not a bad way to transition into retirement, and for this as our hinge moment, to acknowledge the change and to celebrate our ministry together. On July 3rd, 2016, I had my first service here in this sanctuary as your pastor. And what a way for us to begin, for we too celebrated Holy Communion together. And we sang the liturgy that we will be sharing today. And it was such a gift. And then I pointed to the balcony where my grandparents sat every Sunday. And they would bring us to church. You see, they were 70 years old when they drove up in a station wagon to Bloomington, Minnesota, to pack up my mother and her four children and bring us back with an unexpected transition and hinged moment. In a time when single parenting and divorce was frowned on, where women were told to make their beds and lie in it if it wasn't working out, this congregation made a space for a family in crisis. And you didn't have to. But you did. And week in and week out, I would sit up there, and my sister on my first Sunday here, my twin sister, and on my last Sunday gave me wintergreen mints that I've carried this in my pocket, because that's what my grandmother would give us to keep us quiet during church. Every week I would sit up there, scared, anxious, uncertain, and awed by this space. I was awed. And this window was such a gift to me then, as it has been every week I have served here. That sermon that first Sunday, 2016, used the Ephesians passage that reflects how we come from different places and we're no longer strangers or outcasts or aliens, but instead brothers and sisters, citizens with the saints and members of the household of God together. I noted on that Sunday the divisiveness of the church, which has not gone away in 7 years. In fact, we've fractured since then. But God is not fractured. Even as we in our sinfulness continue to divide ourselves into who's in, who's out, who's included, who's not included, I said then, unity is a challenge because it calls forth from all of us the willingness to accept those who are different, to acknowledge that we may not have all the answers, or that we may not know it all. Instead, unity calls us to believe our faith in God, enables us to trust that our unity is not about who we are, but who Christ is, and who Christ will be for us. Which brings us to our passages today. Our behavior, our words, and our faith don't point to who I am personally, or who we are as a community of faith, but who we are in Jesus, and how it is that Christ creates this space and creates this body that is unified. In his sermon on the plain, Jesus notes that we're to love our enemies, do good to those who hate to do unto others as we would have others do to us, to be merciful as God is merciful, to not judge, and to forgive. And I can't think of a better way to embody faith as a pastor than to live out these words. Paul fleshed it out a little differently and a little more definitely. We're in this together, Paul said. Nobody's more important than anybody else. Each of us have gifts, every one of us, and all those gifts are important, which is why we're not to think too highly of ourselves, why we're to tamp down the ego. My gifts are not any more important than any person in this room or who's watching us and participates with us. It is our gifts together at every stage of the journey that is part of building up the community of faith. It is our gifts that call us to let love be genuine, to hate what is evil. Now, you notice it doesn't say to hate people. It says to hate what is evil. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Work at breaking down the walls that divide us. Don't pretend to be more wise or talented than you are. Rejoice in hope, persevere in prayer, extend hospitality. Live in harmony with one another. Rejoice in hope. Bless one another. Don't repay evil for evil. And as far as depends on you and on me, to live peaceably with all. Those words of both Jesus and Paul have been guiding principles for my ministry from the very beginning. And when I wasn't focusing on the behavior, I was trying to focus on to encouraging all of us to live this kind of life of love and faith. And when I wasn't focusing on that, I was reminding people again and again, Jesus loves you. I once got accused that was the only thing I ever told people on Sunday morning. And I said, you say that like it's a problem. Right? Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. And that there is nothing in all creation that can separate us from the love of God. That's, to me, the focus of faith and what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And as I reflect on 41 years of ministry, what comes to mind over and over and over again is just how grateful I am. I am so thankful. I'm thankful for the trust that the Wichita District and the former Kansas West Conference placed in me as I went through the process. First to be licensed, then to be ordained, and then the Kansas West Conference, and now the Great Plains Conference, for every church and charge they appointed me. I'm grateful for all the men and women who have gone before me and blessed me and allowed me to follow and continue to serve the people of the United Methodist Church wherever I went. And my ministry has seen a lot, friends, in 41 years. That first appointment, I walked in with no training, none, zip. I preached one sermon before that one. And I walked in, they showed me the office and showed me a stack of stencils and a mimeograph machine and says, oh, you need to get the bulletin ready for Sunday. Some of you are not old enough to know what I'm talking about. And I didn't take office machines because I wasn't going to be a secretary. And in that first 5 years, I went through a word processor with a dot matrix printer. I know. And then we went to copy machines, computers, the internet, email as being the primary form of communication, and social media. Through it all, some things have changed, but let me tell you, my commitment to Christ through my ministry in the United Methodist Church has not changed. No institution is perfect, but I continue to be blessed and to see by the effort by so many that try to make our faith real in a world that is constantly changing. The United Methodist Church and its predecessor denominations have struggled to live the life that Jesus challenges us to live, to love, to not judge, and in Paul's apt words, as far as it depends on us, to live peaceably with all. And the church has struggled. It struggled first with whether or not we were going to include people of color as being real human beings and equal in the life of the church. Then we struggled with whether or not we should let women have any leadership roles. Heaven forbid. Then we struggled with divorcees. Do we let divorced people serve? Or single people? Or old or young? Then we continue to struggle. How do we include people with disabilities, people that are differently abled? And now we are struggling with how to be fully inclusive for those of the LGBTQ community. And the truth is, that struggle will never end if we are open to where God is leading us as a community of faith to be there for all people in all places and making sure all are welcome and know the love and grace of God. That's never, ever going to change. As I reflect on the scriptures this morning, I want to particularly thank those people in those churches that I've served. I want to thank the people of Alden who were saints, folk. They were saints. That first sermon I practiced, it was 7.5 minutes until I got up and preached it, then it was 3. I knew nothing. I mean, this was before 911. Well, go, Cindy, down to that section, and then you're going to take a mile and a half to the next section. Right? I was a city girl. We had street signs. And they loved me. And they put up with me going to seminary and experimenting on them. Thank you to Hyo Kelly, who I mentioned, who was 80 years old when I came to Alden, that he'd been serving for a year, and he charged that congregation to help me become the pastor that I wanted to become. So I need to thank the people of Alden. And then the Jewell County Parish, that were seven churches, Baroque, Esben, and Odessa. The Odessa congregation was fabulous because it was a county seat with no running water. And trust me, I did not want to use the outhouse at 8:30 in the morning, because you had to knock to make sure the scurrying or the slithering went away before you used it. Seven people, but boy, they loved Jesus. And Esben and Baroque, those three churches, those folk, I became pregnant with my youngest son there, and the folk at Odessa knew before I was, because they were cattle people. And I was just part of the livestock. When I announced it, they went, "We knew that 3 weeks ago, Cindy. How did you not know?" God, thank you to those folk for their ministry. From there, I went to Plainville, and God bless them. They were good people, and they walked with my ex-husband and my children and I through divorce, and they loved us and all four of us and graced us and were with us during that. And Douglas and Rock, where Andrew and I began, we were married down there and got our home together there. And boy, we did lots of exciting, crazy things together. Back to Rice County at Lyons, First United Methodist Church. I was there 8 years, got both Kristen and Joshua through high school. Thank you. Thank you for the ministry you allowed me to do there. Then to West Heights, again a surprise. I'd been a youth director there as a way too young kid in college, and then spent 10 years of ministry. That was such a blessing to me. I thought it was my last appointment, and then I came here. Thank you. Thank you for allowing me to have 7 years here. And having said all of that, I want to ask forgiveness for any wrong I did. Lord knows we all try to do it right, huh? But I know that I missed moments. I know there was ministry I left undone. I know there was words and actions I probably shouldn't have said, and some things I should have and didn't. And I'm sorry for any pain that I caused to any person. The truth is, all I have ever wanted is to be your pastor. And I want you to know that I've loved you every church I've been in. And I do want to ask forgiveness for those things I did not do well. To the best of my ability, I wanted to represent the love and grace of Jesus and live my life according to those words that we heard earlier. And I want to continue to do that once I'm a retired pastor. I want to thank you for inviting me into the most intimate moments of your lives, birth and baptism, death, funerals, confirmation, marriages. You have allowed me the privilege to pray, to cry, to be the presence of God in those moments. Thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you to the bishops and the district superintendents who have prayed for me and appointed me over the years, and to all my colleagues who have been there for me, who have supported me, challenged me, held me accountable as we lived into ministry together. And thank you to my family. My ex-husband, Keith, my siblings, my children, particularly Kristen and Josh, and of course, Andrew. There were many times I was called out when I was not there, when I was unavailable because of my ministry. So thank you for loving me and giving up a lot for me to be in ministry. As I retire, I can't say thank you enough to all the people and all the places that I've been and loved. In our ministry together, friends, we have done good work. We have. We have been the hands and feet of Jesus, and will continue to be in ministry together in new and amazing ways. First Church particularly will continue in ministry with Pastor Amy, who she comes to share her unique and unrepeatable gifts and spirit with you. We have been and will be about the transformation of the world through the love and grace of God. So this week, my friends, may we embody the call of Christ to love, to care, to judge not, and to forgive. With Paul, may we serve the Lord, extend hospitality, bless rather than curse, and so far as depends on each of us, to live peaceably with all. Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Let us continue in worship with another one of my favorite hymns that have guided and directed me. Great is thy faithfulness, it's number 140.
Time in worship where we receive the gifts and offerings, I do want to remind you that as Pastor Cindy said, we each have unique gifts and graces for ministry. Pastor Cindy shared with us 41 years of ministry, but maybe your gifts are just beginning to scratch the surface. Maybe it's volunteering for VBS. Maybe it's going and getting an extra pack of diapers for our diaper drive that's going through Father's Day. Whatever it is, we are all here. We are all called, and we are all moved by the same God. So today, I invite our ushers to come forward to receive the morning offering.
Often times I dream of you sitting. our Downtown Alive worship service. If this service has been a blessing to you and you do not already have a home church, we invite you to prayerfully consider giving a financial gift to the ministry. Thank you for your support.
Be seated. Well, it is time to celebrate you, Cindy. It's that time in the worship service where you see in your bulletin it says celebrating Pastor Cindy Watson. First, I'm going to invite Reverend Dr. Mitch Reese. He is the Wichita East and West District Superintendent, and he is going to share some remarks.
I'll be nice.
Thank you.
I'm going to keep it short. But Cindy, just want you to know, today on behalf of Bishop David Wilson and the Cabinet of the Great Plains Conference, we celebrate with you and First Church in this day. God has blessed the congregations that you have served over your many years of ministry. 41. Wow. You don't look a day over 39. But, you know, through your strong preaching, your bold leadership, and your passion and love for Christ and Christ Church. I know that you all will miss Cindy's leadership amongst you, but I know you're going to be blessed by Amy Leopold as she comes, and Cindy has done a great job in working with that transition. But Cindy, we are just so thankful for you and all that you have done for this church, for the Great Plains Conference, and the larger kingdom of God. You have used your gifts and passions well, and you have been a gift to Christ Church and to those who have served under you. Thank you so much for all of that. And today we pray that you're going to be blessed as you begin this new phase, you and Andrew, and all that you have dreamed and hoped to do in the days ahead. And we trust that Christ is going to continue to use you in this next season to continue to expand his kingdom and whatever that may look like and whatever forms it may take. And I want to leave you with this scripture that you're very familiar with from Philippians 1:6. It says, be confident of this, that he who has begun a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. So we're now going to hear from a couple of other people that want to share some congratulations on this special day.
Thank you for your compassion, your kindness, your concern.
I'm thankful for your leadership over the years, and I wish you nothing but the best and a wonderful and joyful retirement.
Thank you, Pastor Cindy. We'll miss you.
We'll miss you.
41 years of ministry, that is certainly something to be celebrated. I'm really thankful for the years that we had working together at First Church and many great memories.
Thank you for your preaching. It was that which first drew us to watch on KTV during the pandemic. Preaching that is thoughtful, energetic, passionate, relevant, and delivered with good humor and warmth.
Cindy, congratulations on your retirement. Congratulations on your wonderful service to the church, your work across the years. I wish you the very best. God bless you.
On behalf of the whole Wilkie family, Cindy, of which you have many relationships, we're so excited about this new chapter in your life.
When Dick was appointed to First United Methodist Church in Wichita, I came up with Steve to meet the people of this place that has become so precious to us. And I still remember this young woman bounding up to Steve and I and saying, my name is Cindy Watson and I don't ever want you to forget it. And I never have. Congratulations, Cindy, and enjoy retirement.
Congratulations, Pastor Cindy. We're going to miss you. Best wishes in your retirement.
Wishing you and Andrew all the very best in your new adventures coming ahead and in your next chapters of life.
Don't forget that you're always held in the palm of the divine hand.
In the choir. Well, Cindy, I remember the very first phone conversation we had. I was in seminary in Washington, D.C., and I think it was over an hour-long conversation on the phone, and I didn't know what I was getting into, but you were really fun to talk to, and you were encouraging and supportive, and it was everything I was looking for in a mentoring pastor. We've been through a lot. I've had two babies, and you have been like a surrogate grandma. You've told me so much wisdom. And I just think back to being in seminary and that transition into ministry and how you offered grace, a little bit of tough love. Remember when I was working on my ordination?
Thank you for joining us today at First United Methodist Church. Thank you for the privilege of being your pastor through TV, through Facebook Live, or through our online streaming services. It has truly been an honor to serve you over the last 7 years. And I hope you know that I love you and that I know that you will continue to be ministered to through this online broadcast. So know that you are loved. Know that Christ walks with you. Know that the Holy Spirit is in you and surrounding you. And know, wherever it is you are called to go on this journey we call life, you are always held in the palm of the divine hand.
Before Sunday schools today, we announced to the congregation, because I don't think we trusted anybody to stay quiet for the most part. So hopefully you're surprised. But as of now, we have over $10,000 already contributed, and that was before Sunday schools this morning. And I'll read a little bit about what the scholarship's supposed to do. In conjunction with the Kansas Methodist Foundation, the Reverend Cindy Watson Seminary Scholarship is designed to encourage Kansas women to follow their calling from God and prepare them for ordained ministry as elder in the United Methodist Church. We apply towards tuition, fees, room and board for the basic seminary degree leading to elder's ordination. And the scholarship shall be awarded to a female applicant or applicants seeking a Master of Divinity degree at the University Senate-approved School of Theology. So.